welcome. Thank you. If anyone needs the bathroom, you're going to ask yourself a question. If I was a bathroom, where would I be? And the answer to that is the back corner by the kitchen. Also, if you're thirsty and you want a beer, you can ask yourself the question, if I was a beer, where would I be? And the same answer is back there by the kitchen, glass of wine, water. If you want to make tea, it's back there. So this is a self-serve environment. They follow others in the culture of Genius Den. We carry our own bags. This is Charlie Horton. Came here, took an hour and a half out of Fort Worth.
Flower Mound
today. All of us have come a long way to spend the evening listening to Charles talk about fear. Talk about how our fear holds us back. And talk about how getting past that can get you where you want to go. And you can channel their talents where they can have the hugest impact. So that's a lot of the values of Genius Den. We've got three core missions. We want to be a force multiplier. We want to figure out things that have a big impact. And having you all here tonight is part of that. We want to bring the future into the present. So if you were bringing on a new technology or a new method of doing things, then we're really interested in talking to you and helping you. And we're really focused on interrupting cycles of poverty. And those are as simple as saying, let's figure out how to get at kids before they learn to despair and become a part of the problem and a part of the system of abuse. And it's also about ourselves, because I see it a lot of times. I've been in a lot of forums, meetings, where there's a couple of CEO guys that were college buddies, they were teammates in a company, and 3 years or 8 years later, all they can do is try to get away from each other, the corporate divorce. A lot of that comes from who you are, where you want to be, what you want to do in life. A lot of people leave a corporate job, the boss who's stressed out, doing too many things, yelling at everybody, making everybody miserable, and they go get free, and they start getting good at it, they find a customer and a bunch of customers, and they're good at this, and they bring in more people, and then they become that same screaming, stressed out boss. So we want to avoid that too, right? We want to learn how to let go and get through. So welcome. Bathroom in the back, beer in the corner. If y'all need to leave, anything happens, emergency, whatever, feel free to just quietly check out. So Charles has graced us by coming in. He's engaging in this stage in his life after getting the water out of his boat and building a big enough boat and other little boats around him and setting sail and having good people pulling the ropes on those sails and spending more of his time connecting to folks like us so he can get us to our 20 million, which is hard but not impossible, right?
Correct.
He owns, depending on how you count them, either 90 companies, because the corporate structure of one of those companies has multiple locations, or six companies, one of them a bit larger than the other ones. But he's built two companies to 20 million and beyond, but the focus is more about getting to that 20 million. So welcome to Genius Den. A quick show of hands and a quick question. How many of you are here for the first time tonight? It's a good show. That's two-thirds. Thank you. I'm honored to have you, and this is why we're here. Charles, I think that's a good rambling introduction. We'll let you take it from here. Thanks very much.
And thank you, Joe, for hosting us. Give Joe a big round of applause. Or since he's calling me Joey, he's calling me Charlie, I gotta call him Joey, I guess. I'd like to get to know you guys first, so if we could take 10 or 15 seconds where everybody stands up again in 10 or 15 seconds, who you are, where you're from, what you're doing. And I especially like to know what stage of business you're in.
Patrick Jackson. I have an online marketing company called Action Online Marketing. I'm here in Dallas, Texas, and I'm in the second stage of my business, affiliate marketing.
Keen Richardson. I shoot commercials 9 to 5, but I'm an aspiring entrepreneur with a concept that I'm trying to launch.
I'm Valerie Davis. I have a patent firm. I've been in business for about 5 years, and I'm ready to expand and grow.
Mark Alverson, I operate a accounting services firm for small and mid-sized companies.
Hey Contessa, and life relationship coach. I help you achieve your goals faster and more efficiently. I also have a nonprofit where we feed families with Thanksgiving meal.
I'm Tracy J. Pierce. I'm an author four times. I'm a founder of a nonprofit called Phenomenal Woman, and I'm in the beginning stages of a new company.
You need to do a talk, because it took me 20 years to get my first book up.
Hi, I'm Chef Cassandra Armstrong. I'm known as a healthy chef. I provide healthy meals for people who are in transition with a new lifestyle change. And I'm approaching my 25th year in business, but I'm expanding the personal chef arm, and so that's why I'm here. And I'm an author as well.
I'm Terry Tooney. I'm the president of Score Dallas. We help small businesses get started and be successful. I'm also launching a new 501c3 called the Industry Hub, and we help communities identify where there'll be job loss, where new jobs are going to be created, and how it's going to impact your business.
I'm Bruce Mahirin. I have an IT services company. I can help all of you with your websites and email and everything you got. And I'm also her CTO for her new food found company. We hope to transform communities and make things a whole lot better. One of them's going into high school.
Any place I speak at, by the way, I like to make it a networking group. I listen really closely because I generally end up doing business with somebody in the group. So be sure you're listening to all of these introductions, and after we're through, make some connections and introduce yourself to a few people.
Hi, I'm Ariba Kamal. I sell enterprise software, but I'm wanting to get away from that and take pro.
I am Denise Alvarez, and I am a community relations patient advocate in our county hospital. But I am also planning to something to change the education in our community.
Hello everyone, my name is Felicia Lopes. I run a company called BusyGal that basically has as its mission to make business owners, authors, coaches, speakers, and mentors look fantastic to their target clients. I do that through social media marketing, through social video marketing, website design, and virtual assistants. And I have another secret agenda as well to help women over 40 become authors.
It's not secret anymore.
Hi, my name is Sean Arthur. I'm a small business owner. The name of the company is Dismayed Resources. We service the upstream oil and gas sector, so it's really attractive. Companies are our primary target audience. And I've had the company for going on 6 years. And I'm just here to continue my education.
Good evening, I'm Scott Schilling. I'm a speaker, trainer, author, business coach, TV show host of Talking with Giants, and a serial entrepreneur. That's French for been broke multiple times.
Hello, I'm Joan. I'm a firewalker. I also have a product, something for Saver, and I'm here this evening to assist Charles. Looking forward to saying hello to everybody.
And Scott, as we work together, I hope to break that pattern of being an entrepreneur of going broke often, because that doesn't have to be the pattern.
I get that.
Hi, my name is Myron Lamb, and my agency is Magnum 360. We do web design and mobile. Yeah. My name is Myron Lamb with Magnum 360. We do web design and mobile.
I'm Nancy Hong. I am with Texas Women's University. Women's University. So the governor has tasked us to make Texas number one in women-owned businesses. And they also put some money in this one, right? So talk to me, women-owned businesses afterward. But what I do is I take students' ideas to start up. That's my secret sauce from the West Coast, the government.
I'm Isaiah Engel, and I do account-based marketing for a company in town called Dex Media.
And you also built a startup?
Oh, yes. I'm also a former founder of the startups, a couple startups.
Okay, we'll go back into the audience here in the lady in the stripes and then come back out to those standing.
Hi everyone, my name is Cynthia and I'm trying to start a virtual restaurant to meet busy young professionals. But how to start?
My name is Bria Ratliff. I'm a curriculum developer and a mathematics education professor at SMU. I own my own education consulting business called Means of Power 3, where we train teachers and students and write curriculum and other things to build education.
Hello everybody, my name is Arthur Mangum, and I've been employed with FedEx Ground for 21 years, and I spent here to learn how to expand my business. So we created a, started a refrigerated division. I'm trying to network and grow my business in there.
Hi everyone, Kim Sinabarachi, co-founder of Spice Man. We're a global lifestyle brand delivering a spice subscription box to a different country every month to help people connect with each other over food and to other cultures, all through the spices. Oh, and we're almost 2 years in business.
Hi guys, I'm Ash. I'm involved in a couple of different companies in the C-store industry. I'm in year two of my latest startup that we just did training. So
it's a good feeling.
Yes. Hi, I'm Ali. I have a healthcare business. Sold one of the divisions a few years ago. I wanted to do something a little different, so I started a men's salon, barbershop, not yet, and it's like the healthcare business.
My name is Mark Morris. I'm in commercials.
TV commercials?
No, commercial real estate. Real estate.
Next row back there.
Oh, I thought I was the last one to walk in. My name is Anthony Campbell. I am coming to join the group tonight. Joe invited me, but you know, being in a group of all of us in a room like this, wanting to create and grow things, truly inspires me. I'm on my third startup, working a lot of ways now. I've kind of been stuck in my shell as a turtle. I got funded and we've been really heads down and focused. But it's been about a year and a half, almost 2 years since I've been in a room with a group of people like this. You guys, this is inspiring. It reminds me of what I've missed. But hearing everybody talk about wanting to do this and wanting to do that, being part of that, you know, Nancy and I go way back. But guys, this is the reason. I can feel the hair standing on my skin right now. Being in the room with people like this really inspires us. Being part of this group in North Texas is amazing. And my hat's off to Joe and the group for putting this together. Thank you for inviting me. Of course, we'll be back in the team.
And you said it just the way I believe. That's why I'm here. I love being around the energy of entrepreneurs.
I'm a sort of boy, born to it, and I'm in the early stages of real estate.
My name is Gabriela.
My name is Thomas Heidinger. I'm from Germany. I work for a large company in the bagger stamping industry. Before I worked in the train industry and decided to do some real estate for that bagger stamping.
My name is Gula. I work for Smiths, where I mainly digitalize supply chain. And as I mentioned, Joe, I come from a much smaller group, but I have to do a really big organization, so I'm like a smart lucky and working.
I'm Shirak Desia. I actually go on tech from here in Dallas. We just provide global solutions to businesses and startups. Great to be here.
My name is Jeff Bones, and I have a company called Tina's Art. So award-winning artists with disabilities. It's a way to empower artists with disabilities to work from their home.
And I think we missed the last row too. And did you go?
Yeah, no. I'm Jeff Brooks. I'm a company made up of an 18-year IT contract in the state of Texas. That's wrapping up, and so 10 of those are spinning off and forming an analytics company.
I'm Bruce Seifried, and I
studying the future of work.
He's a designer, he's an architect.
My name is Calvin, and I'm a part of the UGAD Technical Ballet. We're basically a distributed workforce for basically trying to replace school schools.
What's that? I'm Adam Lacy, and I'm also a partner with these guys in a company called Technical Ballet.
My name is Dan Leonard, and I'm a commercial real estate investor.
I'm John Dean, and I'm a partner in the executive business with these guys.
Did we miss anybody? Well, excellent. Joe, again, thank you for having me here. I am a serial entrepreneur, been going at it all my life. You can go on to the next screen. First of all, I'm going to give a book out at the end, and one thing you'll learn about me is I'm relatively lazy. I want to do as little work as possible to get to the end result. So in the old days, you know, you'd go to these meetings, you'd collect business cards, you'd have to enter them into your contact management system, and for me, it just would never happen. So this is my contact management system. I'm going to give away a book at the end of the night. If you go to charleshorton.com/reg, put your name, email address, and at the end, I will give a book away. And you can stay up with me with my newsletters at the same time. Being an entrepreneur is a whole lot of fun, but there's a lot of stress behind it. I believe you need to find a group that you can make your peers. I've been involved in a CEO club for 25 years. The environment that Joe is creating here is fantastic. It gets you around people that have like minds, that understand what you're doing, that motivate you, that get your energy going. You need that, because if you hang out with a bunch of regular friends that are working the 9 to 5 o'clock, they're not going to understand where you want to go, they don't understand business, and they're probably not going to support you there. So find a group of people that understand what you're doing, and hats off to you. I love this environment. If you weren't an hour and a half away from me, I'd want to have a desk down here just to keep the energy up and going. I am successful, and I've learned to make a lot of money very quickly. I have never gone through the ups and downs of entrepreneurship. I get my tax returns, and I've made money more and more every single year. And my reasoning of doing that is really interesting. When I was growing up, I had an extremely abusive stepfather. He put myself in the hospital multiple times. He put my mom in the hospital multiple times. And I wanted to be independent. I wanted to make sure that I had money to not depend on my parents. And about the only way I could leave the house was to have a job. So I started out doing vending machines, repairing games. Then I started a lawn mowing business. And this lawn mowing business spiraled out of control. My stepfather sold sod, so we were laying grass, we were mowing lawns, and at one point I had 150 kids working for me doing that. And I told you earlier I was lazy. Here's what I found really quick. When doing business with a bunch of kids that are 15, 16 years old, they're not very reliable. So I thought it'd be really cool to grow a big business, have a lot of employees, and I'd be able to sit back and not do a lot of work. Wrong. Half of them didn't show up. I'm mowing lawns all day long, trying to interview in between, trying to hire more people to mow more lawns. And I just decided that was way too work intensive for me. But I did learn that it was pretty cool at the time. I was charging approximately $20 an hour as a kid to do the lawn, and I was paying probably $5 an hour. So if I actually got somebody to do the work for me, I was making $15 an hour for not doing anything. So I learned the power of having a team and making money by creating a team and empowering the team. So the next business came up. And the next business was flea market check cashing. I'm 15 years old, and I go to a flea market in Austin, Texas, and I want to write a check for something that I want to buy. And the merchant says, they don't take checks. I started asking around, nobody took checks. My parents are living in a mobile home. We're poor. I didn't think about it that way at the time, but we were poor. But I never let any of that stop me. So I went to the flea market owner and I said, would you let me build a booth and cash checks? It will help all of your merchants out here do more business. And the guy said, sure. So they built me a plywood booth in the middle of this flea market with a plywood flap that I'm surprised never broke and cut somebody in half at my check cashing window. They cement in a safe. And this is, again, a very open 400 merchant flea market in Austin. Next problem, what do you need if you're going to cash checks?
Cash.
I don't have any cash, I'm a broke kid. I can't even get to the flea market without hiring me a driver. So I raised about $10,000 from friends. That was my first business raising, but that didn't cover but maybe an hour worth of check cashing. So the next thing I did is I went back to the flea market owner who owned all the concession stands in the flea market. I went to him and said, you know, you have all these concession stands, you have armored cars running in and out, taking your cash away, and that's a cost to you. Why don't you let me buy your cash? I'm 15, 14 years old, I don't even have a driver's license. And I'm telling this guy, I want to buy hundreds of thousands of dollars a weekend in cash from you. Will you trust me to do that? How many of you, if you were the flea market owner, would have kicked me out immediately? I guess most of your hands going up. I guess I exuded a lot of confidence. The guy said, sure. So every hour on the hour, I went to their cash room, and I took all the cash they had. I wrote a check for that cash. I took the cash, went back, cashed a lot of checks, and I did that all weekend long. Generally about $200,000 a weekend worth of checks, and I was charging a convenience fee of 10%. Do the math. I was making a lot of money as a 14, 15-year-old kid. So I deposit all these checks on Monday morning, and then they deposit all their checks, and then back then it took about 10 days to clear checks, and so I developed through float a lot of extra cash in the bank too. I got so good with my bank that some days I would start cashing more checks than I would have cash from the flea market, and I would go in with all the checks that I had just cashed deposited. They would give me instant credit and give me $40,000 or $50,000 more cash.
Wow.
So 14, 15 years old, making $20,000 a weekend. Now, how many of you are now thinking, but what about the bad checks? How many of you are thinking that? This is something that I never had a fear. I just don't have fears. That was not something that really concerned me. I wasn't afraid of the bad checks. I have no verification system. I'm taking checks from everybody who walks up. But I had a great tool. I had the district attorney's office. It's a criminal offense to write a bad check, even if you're getting cash for it. So I found out that was a profit center. I found out that I was cashing on average about a $100 to $200 check, so my fee's $20. Well, if the check bounced, I made an extra $25 as a bad check fee. So I looked forward to the checks bouncing. I would send a letter. I would give them 10 days to pay. If they didn't pay, then I would file a warrant for their arrest with the district attorney's office. My bad debt was like next to nothing. Out of the $20,000 in a weekend that I may get in fees, I probably had $1,000 to $2,000 worth of initial bad debt. And through our collection efforts, when I closed the business down, I had very, very, very little bad checks, like a total of $5,000 or less worth of bad checks. So that's really what started my career going. I learned that bad checks were a lot of money, made a lot of money. So I started going out, and by the way, at the check cashing venue, I decided to get smarter. Instead of having lines of people and cash at my booth, I went ahead and got the merchants to go ahead and take the checks, come in to me at the end of the weekend. I had at the back of the booth, we had a merchant section, and we would sit there with the calculator, typing up all of the checks, take our 10% discount, give them a check for their checks. So I was moving a lot of checks around. So I would deposit their checks, they would take my check, deposit my check, and then anything that went bad was my problem. Then I started learning that there is a lot of money in that. So I started going out to other merchants, getting their bad checks. I started out doing check collection, and then I learned about check verification. I had a data room. At one point at my height on Christmas, we were processing like 10,000 checks a second. in some cases, it was fun watching the computer screen just roll. You couldn't even see the transactions going up. I had a bank of modems, and we had every check that was taken go through our database so we could stop bad checks. The next level is check guarantee. So I started out just doing check collection. Then I added check verification. And I wanted to get every piece of the puzzle, so I started doing check guarantee. So I would go to trade shows where people were in the business, and I'm there, I'm like 25 years old now, and everybody in the business is my age now, 50 or older, they're well wearing their polyester suits, and they're telling me that to get into the check guarantee business, you have to have millions of dollars behind you. And as they're telling me these stories, I'm thinking, thank God I did not know that. Because if I would have known that it took millions of dollars to get into the check guarantee business, I would have never done the check guarantee business. What I did is I changed one little number in my contract that made this affordable. Most of my competitors bought checks at 7 days. So what that meant is the bad check would come directly from their bank to my office. And most of my competitors would buy that check within 7 days, which did take a lot of cash flow. So I made myself just a little bit cheaper, and I changed that 7 into a 45. And what that 45 did for me is it gave me 45 days to collect the check, probably put a warrant out for their arrest for the bad check before I ever had to pay for it. So that made it to where the fees that I charged to guarantee the checks covered all of the bad checks, and I was never out any cash for the check guarantee. And by doing that, I became the 8th largest check verification guarantee business in the country.
Wow.
I set a goal. How many of you have read Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill? If you haven't read it, you should write that down. Whenever I'm attending one of these seminars, I write down thoughts, because you get in a creative environment and you get a lot of ideas. And sometimes those ideas aren't even on topic. But one thing that is on topic is, if you have not read it, read Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill. I read that at 18, and I set two goals. I set a goal that I would be a millionaire by the time I turned 30, and I would be a billionaire by the time I turned 50. I did everything that the book said. I worked it into my subconscious mind. I did it over and over. I saw myself having achieved those goals. At age 29 and a half, I'm sitting looking at my business. I have a $20 million company. I have about 150 employees. And I've never made more than $60,000 in a year. I'm so competitive that I leave money on the table. I don't understand business enough to say, take a step back and do not do every deal. So I was doing big, big, big company deals without making any money on it, just to do it, and so my competitors wouldn't have it. So I'm six months away from my 30th birthday, and I'm thinking, you know, I set this goal of being a millionaire by 30. I can easily say that I am a millionaire because my business is worth more than $1 million, but I don't feel like a millionaire because I've never made more than $60,000. So what I did, right then, right there, I changed my goal. I added a word. I want to be a liquid millionaire by 30. So not having any money is one thing. Having a bunch of money in the bank account is another. So I set that goal. I had been working with, I'd had Telecheck back and forth many times. We were friends. They had made offers before, but never big enough. And entrepreneurs seem to think that their business is always worth more and more and more than any buyers will think that it is. Your price as an entrepreneur keeps going up and up and up, generally about 25% more than what your business is really worth. And so I always kept, the number kept getting higher and higher, and we could never come to a T, but I just took a big client away from them. So we're back at the table. I have a goal of being a liquid millionaire by 30, so I have my motivation. They have their motivation because I just took a really big account from them, and I'm like the gnat. I kind of like will sting them, and they keep swatting at me and missing. So they write a number down in excess of $10 million. And at that point, I kept my straight poker face, and I said, yes, I'll take it. So I took the deal, and as most of you would probably think, how many of you have done a cash out in one of your business in excess of $1 million? Anybody? Yeah, congratulations. So you would think that that's going to be the best thing in the world. So understand, my last decade, all of my adult life has been about this company called SmartCheck. You can actually, we're already on to the next one. So called SmartCheck. And I've been doing this all of my life. My company is all of my friends. They're my life. I have not traveled. I don't have any friends outside my business. How many of you recognize that in your own company now? You do nothing but work and all of your friends work with you. That's where I was. All of a sudden, I have in excess, I had over $10 million after taxes. So I'm in a pretty good position. I had not increased my standard of living too high at that point. I could easily live off of that for the rest of my life. And I'm thinking I'm going to do that. So I start day trading, I start just kind of doing those type of things, and within 6 weeks, I am depressed. I have no friends, I have no purpose, I'm watching bank accounts go up and down, it's driving me crazy, I'm taking pills because the stress is so high. I tell one story, luckily it was a small amount of money, but I'm day trading, and I do decide to go to Hawaii, my first trip ever. I put all of my stock into two companies. One of them was AOL, and the other one was called Neon, New Era Networks. Anybody remember that company? Are they even around anymore? I wouldn't think AOL's around, but I know John Brown uses an AOL email address, so I guess they're still around. So I put all of my money in those two stocks on market. I go away for 2 weeks. When I come back, I have a margin call, and my broker says, you owe me $5,000. I'm going to look, take it out of my account. No, your account's gone, and you owe me $5,000. Luckily, it was only about $100,000 that I was trading with, but that was my wake up to day trading is not for me. So I find myself at a Tony Robbins seminar, and I learn that especially for men, and I believe it's everybody, I believe that we all need a purpose in life. And I no longer had a purpose in life. And so I immediately went out and started my next business. So my next company that I've had now for 18 years is called FastBucks, and I've grown that. By the way, both SmartCheck and FastBucks was $8,500. So I started growing FastBucks. I grew that up to 78 locations, roughly $20 million in sales, 150 employees, and I've been doing that for a long time. At the same time, I've learned that one business ain't enough. So one of my theories in life is once you get something going well, you hire good people, you let them run the business, and you get on and you do something else. We'll talk more about, I see a lot of you going, thank you. You have that belief too. So I have done that in SmartCheck for probably the last 10 to 15 years. I have a great management team that's going. In the meantime, I've started doing a take on the Shark Tank. I run something called the Boardroom locally, and I hope you guys will come out and join us. Very similar environment, entrepreneurs wanting to get together. Every month, we have one company do a pitch, and I've been doing that now for 6 years. We've had about 40 companies do pitches, and I have six investments of various levels between the companies that I've done, and I divide some of my time into that. I'd say my highlight investment, we had any of you ladies in here ever shop at the White House Black Market? A couple of you, okay. So that the founder of that chain grew it up to 600 stores. He sold it out, made a pile of money. That was about 15 years ago. And he has said I can share this with in my stories. Three divorces, three businesses failed, and about 15 years later, he's finding himself at 60 years old or so, broke. But he did it once, and that's my kind of investment. Is I look for racehorses. I look for people that are really smart, that have a proven track record, and I know can make money. So I'm his only investor, and we're currently at 15 stores in a new clothing concept called Bobo Nation. So
what's the name of your meeting that you meet?
It's called the Boardroom. And I'm going to tell you more about it at the end and give you the information. So I currently have three startups going at once. One of them is related to FastBucks, and it's a competitor to FastBucks, essentially. It's just a new way of providing financial services. FastBucks is a small lender doing installment loans and title loans. Also, I have a billion, what I intend to be my, I told you that I had a billion-dollar goal. This is a funny story for me. So at about age 45, I'm thinking, you know, life is really good. I'm comfortable. I'm not worried about money. I have a lot of things going. Maybe I don't want to work hard enough to be a billionaire. So I kind of let that sit around. The subconscious is a powerful thing. I find myself heading off to South Africa about 3 years ago, and I do crazy things. I walk with lions, I swim with great white sharks, I firewalk, I do all these kind of crazy things. And I'm thinking, this time I got myself set up at a lion farm, and I've gotten them to allow me to go in with all of their lions, including the ones that they won't go into. So a little bit of me is saying, you know, what happens if I die? I do have a decent net worth. I have money, but I don't have a will. I really do, but nobody knows I have a will. So if I die, that lawyer isn't looking to see if I'm still alive or not, and none of my relatives know that I have a will anywhere. So they have no idea where to look. So I'm thinking, we really need an electronic solution to that. So I started designing Secure Vital about 3 years ago now. We're currently out in beta, finally. It's been a long process. But basically, Secure Vital will be a platform to securely store your data. So everything from your bank accounts, your credit cards, your health information, things you're allergic to, the medications you're on, things you like, things you don't like, insurance that you have, safe combinations. So it stores all of that, but it's also a platform. So we're going to help you. We're going to educate you on the legal documents you have. LegalZoom would be one of our partners. So if you need a dying declaration, we would explain to you what a dying declaration is and pass you off to LegalZoom to write that. We're thinking that we'll possibly partner up with OpenTable. So when you go into a restaurant, you open up your iPad or your smartphone, it's gonna know you're there, it's gonna know what your likes and your dislikes and your allergies are, and it's gonna give you what you probably want to eat at the top. And when you push place order, it puts in your allergies and that type of thing too. So I set a goal of that being worth $1 billion in 3 years. I'm 2 years from my 50th birthday, and it never dawned on me that at first that my subconscious mind said I was going to be a billionaire by 50. And with having kind of consciously given up on it, my subconscious mind keeps going. And now I hope, I know, correct my own language as we do this, I know it's going to have me at my $1 billion goal by 50. So that's kind of what I'm into now. You can press forward a couple more times. So that's what Secure Vital is about. A couple of lessons I got out of this. People ask me why I've been successful in life, and I will tell you the number one thing that I say is from a young age, I know that I don't know everything. And whether you're 18, whether you're 25, whether you're 30, 40, 50, or 60, most entrepreneurs who have really big egos never get that. They think they know it all and they don't need any help. So from the time I started, when I started my check verification business, I started it in my bedroom, basically. I went out and I found a salesperson who just got out of the military, had a paycheck, wanted something to do, wanted that purpose I was talking about. And so he went out and sold during the day, brought in the checks, I entered them into the computer, I made the phone calls at first, and I had no expenses in a salesperson other than commission. So he ate what he killed, essentially, and that worked really well. As the company could afford it, we got employees that made the phone calls and did the data entry. At some point, we moved out of my house and then got a big office and kept going. During that whole time, though, I knew I needed a good lawyer because this is a legal-oriented business. I didn't have money for a lawyer, so I found a lawyer that would take a small part of my company. He would be on my board of directors, and he would do my legal work. I believe strongly, and so many entrepreneurs that I coach do not get this. I believe strongly that you must have accurate, timely financials. How many of you in here get accurate, timely financials so you know where you are? About 25% of the room. That's another thing. If I were you, I would write down, you got to have accurate, timely financials so you know where you are. If you don't know where you are, you can't hit your goals. You can't figure out problems. In my company, we blow away our banks and our lenders' minds because of the data we have. I can get on my iPad right now and tell you to the second all of the key business elements that we look at, which would be bad debt, profitability, and payroll percentages. I can get that to you practically to the minute. And as far as end of the month financials, we have our preliminary financials on the third of the month and our final financials on the seventh of the month. If you take longer to get them out and you're not regularly having meetings with your people, they're not going to understand the business flow. If you're making money, how do you make more money? If you're losing money, how do you stop that loss? So I created that team for stock. And all of them from the first business did really, really well. So I had a financial guy, I had a sales guy, and a legal guy that worked for me for free, essentially, and took a little bit of stock. Cost me in the end, but I had really good talent. Have a good, strong group of advisors. I was at a Tony Robbins seminar one time, and Tony was saying that you should be using your time in one of three ways. Making money, giving back, or having fun. One of those three ways you should be spending your time. So for instance, should you be cleaning your house? No, you shouldn't spend time cleaning your house if you hate it. So that was Tony's remark, and he said, I absolutely hate cleaning my house. So before I had any money whatsoever, I look at the value of my time. Even if you don't have a value, even if you can't equate exactly what you're making now, I say $1,000 an hour is what my time value is. And if I'm not making $1,000 an hour out of it, or giving back, or having fun, I'm not going to do it. So what Tony did is he created coaching agreements with his housekeepers. They wanted coaching, and he wanted housekeeping. So he didn't have money for housekeeping. That's how he got his housekeeping done. I've had multiple millionaires on my board since I was 18 years old. I find things that give them value. I've never paid them except in stock that they were able to turn around and cash out later. So I find things that they enjoy. People that are getting of age need the purpose as well. I have a gentleman that has been with me now as an investor for 15 years. He came in and was a partner in many of my stores, helped me grow, brought in other partners, and he got sick about 4 years ago. He had to cash out of being a partner because he thought he was passing. He didn't. He's in good health now, and he still comes to our monthly board meetings because he has fun, he feels value, and he has a purpose. So the moral of all of this is make sure you have a good advisory team around you. Have people around you that are where you want to go. I always had millionaires on my advisory board. Frankly, I have exceeded all of their net worths. So recently, it's been 6 years now, but recently when I decided that the billionaire was where I was going, that I went out and found a billionaire to be on my advisory board, and now I use him as my primary mentor, but I still keep all of the rest of them around too. Any questions so far?
You're blowing us away.
I'm sorry?
You're blowing us away.
Excellent. I'm not wasting your time then, right? So by the way, this was originally an hour and a half presentation. Joe said people don't want to sit around and hear stories, so I kind of cut this down. So be sure you write down questions, because at the end we're going to go to a question and answer session, and I want you guys to make sure that whatever you want to know, you're getting out of me. Yes, sir?
Charles, quick question. And Joe and I were having this conversation last night. You know, many people hear speakers and mentors talk about surrounding yourself with strong advisors. What's your advice for people that maybe don't know where to look for those, right? Because there are some advisors that have no business being advisors, and they're going to lead you in the wrong direction. So what are some of the key things you did to help you identify, one, is this a good advisor? And two, where are some of the areas they might be looking for those?
So first of all, you're in the right place right now. This is the start of the place to go. Yep. Find a group of people that are going in the same direction you are. At my boardroom that I'm doing, I have now suddenly started having 2-3 billionaires in the room at a time that aren't even on the panel. So I'm attracting those people just to my group. So please come hang out at my group. The cost is very minimal. It's once a month and you will get a lot of education out of it. And it's a great place to get your mentors. I found most of my mentors through the CEO club that I joined. And I hung around people, I got to be friends, and then I handpicked the ones that seemed to have the knowledge and skill sets that I wanted. Is that a good answer? Okay, any other questions about anything that I've asked or covered so far? You're pointing over here, yes ma'am.
I am on the other side of that question. And so that if I have too many people who approach me and want me to be the advisor, how do I sort of weed them out so they know those who waste my time?
Very good question.
You send them to SCORE.
Good answer too. And tell everybody about SCORE in a little while. Right as I end, I'd love for you to tell everybody about what you do. So what I do is I believe that life is too short to not have fun. So I like to get to know. I think everything's about relationships. I have a group of people that I've been working with 10 years. If I need something, they trust me implicitly because I've always done what I say, but we all have a lot of fun. So I take my employees on trips around the world. So last year we did Thailand and we did South Africa. It's an incentive trip if your numbers are up. My mentors go with me because they have so much fun hanging out that they want to go and keep that energy going. So my answer to you is find the people that you click with. Find the people that you're going to have fun hanging around, and the people that make your skin crawl and give you knots in your back, get rid of them. And I have both. I love being helpful. I love working with entrepreneurs that are excited and have passion and energy. I love to give time to those people. But if I don't have fun doing it, life's too short. I'm sorry. You're gone. And you have to be working hard too. If you're not working hard, if you're not taking my advice, if you're not doing something with it, I'm going to back away too. Having said that, in my CEO club, we do these things called PACs, Presidential Advisory Councils, and we get into groups of about 10 people, and we get to know each other's business intimately. And I use the same structure in the boardroom. So the structure in the boardroom is you get 15 minutes to do a presentation. You get about 15 minutes for the panel to ask you questions, and then you get 15 minutes where we give you advice. So the packs were the same format, only about 2 hours each. So if it was my turn to present, I would have 2 hours to present my business, my financials, introduce you to the people in my company, give you what my issues are and what I want your advice on. Then the panelists would come back, ask me questions, I would answer the questions, and then the rest of the team would give advice. And the joke of the group was you would get this tape at the end that would give you all of the advice, and you probably never used any of it. So you have to, most entrepreneurs are ego-centric, and they're not going to take your advice. And I want somebody that's dropped their ego. They want the knowledge, they want the advice. Doesn't mean they're gonna do everything I say. Not everything I say is probably a good idea, but they're gonna at least listen and consider all of the advice that's given. Any other questions on what I've covered so far? Okay, we'll go on to the next one. Jay Rogers came to me, one of my top mentors. Joe went to a group that we were both involved in called Business Owners Ed. And so Business Owners Ed meets for 10 weeks, and it's 4 hours a night, and you have 2 to 3 top-notch speakers come in each night. It's kind of a master's in business education in a way. You get a lot of good information from it. And Jay Rogers has been one of my long-term advisors. He's the one that heads up the group. I've known him 15 years. And he has two pieces of advice that I take really, really, really strong. The first one, your first job as CEO is to work yourself out of a job. The first time he told me that, I'm sitting back going, no, this is about me. I'm the only one that holds all this together. If it wasn't for me, this company wouldn't exist. And as I listened more and more to what he was saying, it made so much more sense. If your business is going to have an enterprise value, if somebody's going to come along and buy your business, it has to be able to operate without you. Because if somebody's going to buy your business and give you value for it, they know you're not going to stick around. The people from Smart Check, for instance, I had to stay for a year as part of my contract to help the rollover. So they give me my check. I'm around for a year. The second week, the guys come and say, you know, if we need you, we'll call you. They didn't want me around the office. They needed to develop their own relationships with my employees, but they wanted to know that they could call me back if I was needed. And they did a great job of integrating the business into their own. They had that experience. They had done it over and over. Hire people that are smarter than yourself and motivate and empower them. To me, that's my job as the CEO of SmartCheck. I'm sorry, FastBucks. At FastBucks, that is my primary income source, and it's a significant one. I probably spend an hour a day, at most, on FastBucks. I have a 15-minute call with my staff. I do that every day, and we kind of consider it a stand-up call. We talk about whatever we need to talk about during those 15 minutes, and that's where I do the majority of the business. I then also handle fires. So if there's something that I need to get involved in, I'm the guy that gets involved and does that. About an hour a day is what I spend on my primary company. Because what I have done is I have hired people smarter than myself, and I find ways to motivate and empower them. The executive vice president of my company was a banker until he turned about 30. And then he was a check casher. He ran check cashing stores. Then he got involved in mobile check cashing. Then he went and did a mobile armored car business. So he would have an armored van that would go up to businesses like fast food restaurants, convenience stores, and they would take money, but they also had a bank. So if you needed change, they would give you that money back. Very successful entrepreneur. And he failed in that last business. 9/11 came along, and I don't know what 9/11 has to do with mobile check cashing, but his business failed right after 9/11. I was able to recruit him in, and he's a very, very smart guy, and I found a way to motivate him and empower him. He runs the company, he runs the management or the administrative part of the company, and it's pretty well his to run his way. He's very good at what he does, very smart at what he does. So, top rule there, work yourself out of a job. Next slide. Create a business that serves you. Here's another lesson that I got out of Jay Rogers. I had never been traveling much, and Jay Rogers is a very good salesman. I'm hanging out with him one day and he says, give me your credit card. I'm going like, why? Because you're gonna go on this trip to South Africa with us. And I said, no, I don't wanna go to South Africa. Just give me your card, you can cancel later. You know, keywords, so here I am, getting my credit card out, handing the credit card over to him. He signs me up for South Africa. $40,000 is what this trip costs for two. I try to get out of it multiple times, and he talks me into going, and now I'm basically showing up at the airport with my shoulders down because I've been made to go on this trip that I don't want to go to. Watch Jay, he's good at this. So I show up in South Africa, and there are 20 of the brightest people I have ever met. Other CEOs, guys that have $500 million companies, there was a billion-dollar hedge fund manager in the group, just really cool guys. So the value in the trip was very clear that it was in the people that you were getting to know. But I also got out, I saw South Africa, fell in love with South Africa. I'm really good with numbers. So on this trip, I wrote down the rack rate of everywhere we went. And I made a good guess at the transportation costs. I looked it up online. And again, rack rate, I looked it all up. Rack rate, if I would have paid the asking price with no discounts on everything, was $20,000. There were 20 couples on this trip. Jay Rogers made $250,000 taking people that needed to be together, that had a lot to give each other, that had a lot of value, bringing the right people to the table, and he made $250,000 in a 2-week trip showing people around South Africa. And he does this trip every year. Taught me a big lesson. Find ways to let all of your hobbies make you money. I was telling you that I've always been really good at money, other than right after the check cashing business when I was like 16 years old. Every other year in my life, I've made more money year after year after year, and I've started looking for ways to find to whatever I do, I make money at. So for instance, I like to travel. I like Hawaii. I like scuba diving. I have a condo in Hawaii that I lease out when I'm not there. By the way, a lot of entrepreneurs, when they start their business, and I just heard this at the Federal Reserve recently, 50% of people run some sort of a small business and they don't know that they do it. That could be babysitting, that could be doing some repair work for the person down the street, and they make the vital mistake of not creating a proper business entity and getting all the tax breaks. So here's a good example of why you create a business. My business in Hawaii is a condo. I need to go there to check up on it on a regular basis. So my flights are tax deductible when I go. Some of my stay when I'm there is tax deductible. All of the expenses related to that unit are tax deductible. I use it and I let my employees go. It's a benefit for working for me. You get free time in the condo in Hawaii. And after 10 years, it's fully paid. So I pay for your travel and everything. I rent it out 9 months out of the year and either use it or let my friends or employees use it 3 months out of the year. I make $50,000 a year and I have all of these tax deductions for doing the things that I love. I'm doing public speaking around the world. I bought out the Firewalking Institute of Research and Education where Tony Robbins learned, T. Harv Eker learned firewalking. And I do the 4-day courses that they learned on how to do those things. Contessa here's done it. Joan back there has done the course. There are two of my local Charlie's Angels who love to help out in the firewalking. But what that does for me is most places I want to travel, I have a business expense in going there. I love South Africa now. I have a chapter in South Africa, so I go there and I talk. They give me speaking engagements, gigs. Now all of my travel is tax deductible when I go there. And I look for ways to make money. So firewalking, I consider a hobby, and I do $300,000 to $400,000 a year. And that's my hobby, so everything else makes more money. Work yourself out of a job and find businesses that work for you. Smart Chick, sorry, Fast Bucks, gives me the lifestyle that I want. It keeps me at the standard of living and it gives me enough money to start all of these other businesses. Right. So Fastbox has become my incubator. I take the profits from Fastbox and I put it into my other businesses so it's not coming essentially out of my pocket. Next slide. One of my first acquisitions, I had SmartCheck. And I got to getting to know your competitors, I think, is very important. I go to all the trade shows and I make sure I know everybody and they know me. So anybody know Southland headquarters really close to here? Southland was my biggest client at one point. In check verification guarantee. They decided to take all their business in-house and they had their business divided among about 15, 20 of my type of businesses. They took it all in-house. And they put managers in charge of it, and they had their own business. Well, these managers got smart, sort of, and decided that they were going to buy the business from Southland and create their own check verification and guarantee company. So they did that, and they ran it a few years. But if you're a middle manager, and suddenly you go from title of manager making $50,000 a year, and now you're a vice president or a president of this big company, what's the first thing you're going to change? Your pay. You're going to change your pay. So they took their pay from being $50,000 a year to $500,000 or more a year. And they had all these new business startup expenses and they didn't understand it. And they came to me and said, Charles, we've signed on this, I think it was a $50,000 phone server. We personally signed on this $50,000 phone server, and we're losing, and I'm making up numbers, I forgot exactly what they were, but let's say I'm losing $750,000 a year. And they just want me to guarantee that that note. And I'm saying, so if I understand you correctly, you want to give me your business that's doing, making up numbers again, say $5 million, you're losing, say, $500,000, and you want to give it to me just so I assume a $150,000 note. Am I correct? Yes, that's what we're saying. And I'm thinking, you know, so I just fire you, and all of a sudden I'm making like $1 million a year, right? I don't say that to them, but that's what I'm thinking. And so I bought the business, I got rid of them, and suddenly I was making $1 million a year. That taught me a very good lesson. And I've seen this in entrepreneurs that I've coached over and over and over and over again. And that is, businesses don't fail, people give up. And they give up for a lot of crazy reasons. They could have dropped their salaries to $150,000 a year, three times more than they were making at their jobs. Right. And they could have had a profitable business, grown it, and made it more profitable, and made more money. Instead, they did the absolute, they made reality out of the worst thing that could happen, which is they would lose their business. They lost their business. I've seen that over and over. Recently, I had a friend that also came through the Firewalking Institute. He's a network marketing genius worldwide. He lived here locally, he moved a couple of years ago, but people that come to my Firewalk instructor training, no matter where they come around the world, if they have anything to do with business and network marketing, they know who this guy is. He had a following. I was impressed. Doing 20 million plus in consulting, essentially, and doing seminars, highly, highly profitable. He brought in tons of people to go up to his Texoma lake house and hang out. Hopefully I haven't told anybody too much to know who that is yet. But about 6 months ago, he just wrote this big long Facebook email, I quit, I gave up, I'm gonna take some time off and figure what I'm gonna do now. He could have sold his business for millions and millions of dollars, and he chose to give up. Ladies and gentlemen, I am here to tell you, having been consulting, having opened multiple businesses and consulting for scores of businesses, there is always a way to get out of every problem. I'm in a business that's very litigious. I've sat in my boardroom where my competitors closed down because of something an attorney general said, where we felt for about an hour like we were gonna close down, and then we changed our reality. We said that's not gonna happen, and we went out and made our reality come true. Always find a way to succeed. There's always a way out of everything. There's always a way to solve every problem. The easy thing for you to do is give up. Don't give up. Keep moving. Next slide. Managing your business. These are five steps, that I use to manage my business. Step number one is remain calm. That's a hard one to do. I'm not good at the day-to-day, Harry doesn't get along with Sally stuff. I'm in a litigious business. There's generally two or three lawsuits going. And if you've ever been involved in a lawsuit, it is a roller coaster ride. One day you're celebrating the best thing in the world happened, and then the very next day you think it's all over and it's time to give up and go home. You got to remain calm, and you got to think about everything clear-headedly, because if you're thinking and making decisions from a state of panic, you are going to make bad decisions. Number two, do not give up. Find a way to solve the problem. If you can't find a way to solve the problem, one of the things I like to do is put it in my subconscious mind, pray on it, whatever you want to call it, go to bed, sleep on it. The answer generally comes to me. I'll give you a good example. In Smart Check days, Diamond Shamrock was 60% of my business, which I think is now Valor. So it was Diamond Shamrock, now it's Valor. Big, big, big convenience store chain, thousands of locations. They canceled on me. And in the check guarantee business, I'm charging a fee, and I'm paying the money back, and it's not a pyramid scheme, but It kind of is. I need the fees to pay the bad checks. I need the fees to pay the bad checks. I need the fees to pay the bad checks. And when suddenly I don't get fees, it becomes very difficult to buy the bad checks. So they cancel on me. I own $2 million. And I told you in that business, I'd never made more than $60,000 a year. I owe them $2 million. I have no more money coming in from them. I'm thinking it's over. I'm thinking they're suing me because this is a legitimate debt. I owe them $2 million. So I go to bed. I'm not good at contracts. I'm good at financials. I understand numbers. I'm not good at legal contracts. When I read a contract, I can read it and think, oh, that makes sense. And then an attorney will tell me what it says, and I'll go, oh my God, that didn't make any sense whatsoever. So I typically trust my attorneys. I had in-house attorneys that wrote the contracts and all. And Diamond Shamrock they put this clause in the contract, and I forgot about it. They put a clause in the contract that said their checks were collateral for any money I would owe them. So the contract ended. I was able to take all of these worthless checks that I couldn't collect and give them back to Diamond Shamrock, and I didn't owe him $2 million anymore. Wow. Saved my life, and it came to me overnight, whether that be law of attraction, God answering my prayers, whatever your belief system is, it came to me overnight. I put a lot of trust in the law of attraction and praying. Take advantage of it. Those things can just come to you. Same thing works for me for getting to the right people. So for instance, I'm planning on this Secure Vital where I'll need potentially $50 million in advertising for the first year. I've done really well, but I don't have $50 million to put into advertising to flush down the commode. So my mentor on a trip to Thailand, one of my incentive trips, my mentor finally caves in and says he'll fund it. And then a couple of weeks later, we go to his favorite steakhouse being Bob's. I'm blanking on the guy's name right now, but the president of Hobby Lobby is there with him, and he's interested in funding the whole thing. So the people that I need to fund the business, I just kind of put it out there and it comes to me. I just keep moving forward, kind of like that baseball movie, build it and they will come. Back to what we were talking about here. Remain calm, do not give up. See things as they are, not worse than they are. That one you need to repeat to yourself over and over and over and over again, because when you're in a state of panic, when you're not in a good mindset, when you're not remaining calm, you're going to see things in the absolute possible light. And that's going to cause you to give up. Don't give up. Remain calm. See things as they are, not worse than they are. Next, see things how you want them to be. And finally, make them how you want them to be. I started a story earlier where an attorney general had decided that they were setting an 18% APR rate cap. In my business, I'm making $300 loans. An 18% interest loan would mean that for 25 cents, you're coming into my office, talking to my person, we're generating a loan, and I'm taking a $300 risk on you without even checking your credit. How many in here would loan somebody that they don't know $300 for a quarter? You know, hopefully none of you. So that's essentially what the Attorney General was saying. It would wipe our company out of business. Many of my competitors quit and gave up. What we did is we said, the Attorney General doesn't write laws. The Attorney General does not have the right to do that. The Attorney General enforces laws. So we sued the Attorney General. We got an injunction against the Attorney General from trying to create law. Matter of fact, the judge said to her, if you want to be a legislator, give up your job, run, and become a legislator. And these keys are so important. And until you repeat them over and over and over in your head, you probably think I'm absolutely crazy. But to be an entrepreneur, you got to be a little crazy. You got to be able to create your own reality. And that's really what entrepreneurship is to me, is finding a vision, defining the vision, and making that vision come true, generally by leading and motivating other people. Next screen.
So just to pause.
Yep.
You sued the Attorney General.
I did.
One.
I did.
Okay.
I fought the law and won. You can do that with states. I would not try that with the federal government. They got a lot of deep pockets. So I want to take a moment before getting into the boardroom and see if you have any general questions. Yes, sir.
How do you instill a culture of learning a couple levels below your people?
I don't understand your question.
So you have a great executive team.
Yep.
But what if they're really great to you, but they're not the best? What if they're really not great at leading people, and you don't know it because they're great to you? How do you know that they're good all the way down the chain?
So I'm running into that now. I have an IT guy, for example, that is absolutely brilliant at IT, but he makes employees want to quit if they have to deal with them. So what I do in those cases is he has Asperger's. He is not good with people, but he is brilliant at what he does, and he keeps our computers going. We've never lost any data. So what I do in that case is I take him out of the roles that he's not good at, and I put him into the roles that he is good at. So now all of the IT-related questions have to go through the district managers. The district managers are the liaison to IT, and then we have meetings on a regular basis, and we do team building events, so everybody works together and gets to know each other. If you're sitting on a phone call, on a phone across from somebody, it's really easy to be snide or smug with them, but when you have to work in team building events, and you have to figure out ways to do things, and you have to work together as a team, and you learn from it, then all of a sudden you can work together in your offices. So we do developmental training, make sure all of our team works well together, and then when they don't, we look to move their assignments and their tasks in the area of their competency. Not everybody can do everything, in other words. Thanks. Yes, ma'am.
What do you do when you have too much passion, too much talent, too many ideas, just too much? God just keeps pouring on me. Do this. Wait a minute, I haven't done that yet. You know, I can't keep up with so much being poured onto me, and I think I'm going to explode. I just have too much.
Taking a deep breath. To me, it's a matter of where you are in business. When I started Smart Check, when I started Smart Check, I did nothing but Smart Check. I did one thing, and I did one thing well until it paid me enough money to replace me in the talent pool and it let me go on to something else. So now FastBucks affords me the ability to pay the people that need to run FastBucks and allows me to go out and do what I do best. So if you're not there, if you're not in a financially windfall position, you need to find that one thing. You need to find the one thing to focus on and focus on that one thing until you get highly successful with it. That's my advice to you from the little information you gave me. By the way, Contessa and Joan, could you pass out give everybody one of those stickies?
Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions? Yes, ma'am. How do I empower people smarter than me? So for me, as an entrepreneur, that's about giving up my ego. As an entrepreneur, I could have the belief that I have to do everything and I have to make every decision. At Smart Check, I had 150 employees. We're all in the same building. I was there at 7 o'clock in the morning and I didn't leave till 10 o'clock at night. Literally, practically, exaggerating a little, if you wanted to go to the bathroom, even if you worked in the collections department and there's three levels of management above you, you had to come and ask permission for me to go to the bathroom. I controlled everything, and as I told you, I never made any money at it. When I went to FastBucks, I took a completely different management approach, and that was to trust everyone else, to trust everybody to make their own decisions. So in FastBucks, I've never had an office at my corporate office. I had a competitor open up 5 stores and he had $5 million to do it with. I opened up 1 store with $100,000 and grew from there. He opened up 5 stores with $5 million and his mentality was that everybody was out to steal from him. He made all the loan decisions. You had to call him for a loan decision and you couldn't do anything without his permission. I always ran it exactly the opposite. The store managers were empowered to make the decisions. They're the ones that knew what they were doing. They're the ones that had the relationships with the customers. The only time you had to call up was if you were going to decline a loan. You never had to call up to approve a loan. So fast forward, He has $5 million in five stores. I start with one store and $100,000. Everything else grew from there. I went to 78 stores. He closed. None of his investors ever got a penny. Difference in management styles. And I think it comes down to that belief system. Because I believed that all of my employees were good. He believed that all of his employees were thieves and bad. I believed that all of my customers were good. He believed that they were all thieves and bad. We were in the exact same markets. He had better looking stores, which you'd think would attract better customers. I went to 78 stores and had been in business 18 years, ate 500 multiple times. He went out of business. None of his investors ever got a penny. So I give my employees the power to do their jobs. The entrepreneur in my corporate office, he is an entrepreneur, but he stayed with me because he earns a piece of the pie. He gets a piece of the profits, and he gets the power to make decisions within his business. One other thing I will tell you is my billionaire mentor right now, his name is D.L. Rogers. He has 230 Sonic stores. He has a little less than 10,000 employees. His Sonic stores, they're headquartered out of Grapevine, his Sonic stores, on average, do as much as 50% better than anyone else in the fast food industry. Why? Because he set up an environment where his store managers were owners. So his store managers own between 10 and 20% of the store. There is almost no turnover within the stores. There's a line full of people waiting to be managers and nobody leaving, where if you go to any other fast food chain, you probably see three different managers in there a year. Keeping people in there, getting them a piece of the pie, keeping them empowered makes you far more money. His advice to me, he says, Charles, if I was trying to run 230 stores, 10,000 employees, and I had to make all the decisions and I was the boss, I wouldn't be anywhere. But instead, I lead, I motivate, I create the systems. I have 230 managers out there that are not managers, they're owners. They own part of the business. They're looking for ways to make more money. So one of his employees, how many of you have had Sonic's Ice? Who loves Sonic's Ice? So back in the day, you couldn't buy Sonic's Ice. One of their manager's owners came to Daryl and said, Daryl, why don't we start selling ice? And they started selling ice for $2. And I'm going to tell you, even though I'm good at financials, I'm not good at remembering exact numbers. So I tell you over and over, I'm making up numbers. I don't remember the exact numbers, because what I remembered was it was a lot of money. But Daryl says he now makes, say, you know, $4, $5, $6 million profit a year because one of his managers came and said, let's sell ice. And not the drug kind, you know, the kind you put in your drink. Did that answer your question? Find people that are smarter than you, give them the power to do their job. I am not a dictator in my business. We get together as a management team and we make decisions. Before, if anybody has ever done the DISC test, anybody in here ever done the DISC test? So I'm a high D, high I, no S, no C whatsoever. And so the way I naturally would lead is I would come to you and I would say, go out and make every call every day and collect to keep your bad debt at 12% or less, and you do it because I say so, and if that's not enough, it's because I'm going to fire you. That's how a DISC would manage, that's how a D-level guy would manage. So an I stands for influence. A manager that is leading through the I will come in and say, take their top management team in, hey guys, we have this problem. Our bad debt's at 18%, it has to be at 12%. What do you think we ought to do? Everybody goes around the room, talks about it, and if they're not going to what I'm thinking, then I may add a little bit in. But we make decisions as a team. And by doing that, when we leave the management meeting, everybody's empowered. Everybody owns that decision. They have a part of that decision. So they leave as an owner instead of somebody saying, God, I hate that boss telling me what to do. He didn't know what's going on. We make our decisions as a team, and we include all of our store managers in every decision that we make, our store owners. Other questions? Yes, sir.
How do you basically use the emotional value to the company, your own company, to sell it?
You have to say it aloud right in here.
How do you lose the emotional value of your company in order to sell it?
To sell it. So here's what I learned about business. I had time after time after time after time that I could have sold Smart Chuck. And emotionally, I didn't want to do that. So I finally do it because I have a goal, I get depressed. Right now, what I do is I have multiple businesses going at the same time, and I simply have a belief that everything's for sale at the right price. So in my business, about 10 years ago, I got an offer of $25 million for the current business. I didn't take it, even though my goal was $10 million. I got into the meeting, and it was with a pawn chain in Austin, Texas. We're sitting at the table, and they write down on a piece of paper $25 million. My attorney, in-house attorney, was a partner in the business, and he spoke first. He took the paper, threw it down, and laughed, and said, "We're worth at least $40 million." I was kind of wanting to pick the paper up and put it back over. No, it's good, but Steve assured me that the number would go up and we just needed to wait. And businesses go through cycles. My business right now is on a big downhill cycle. President Obama, when he took office, made one of his top 10 campaign pledges to run our industry out of business. And so we've gone through a really fun 8 years. He created the CFPB to kind of run us out of business. 3 years ago, we went through something called Operation Choke Point because he couldn't pass laws that eliminated our entities. And so through Operation Choke Point, they went and took away our access to the banking system. So imagine yourself in the financial services business. You're flowing millions of dollars. You're writing checks. You're making deposits. And all of a sudden, all the banks shut you down. So the FDIC would say, "I don't know why that's not happening." And all the banks were shutting us down, our whole industry down, pointing over to the FDIC. We had to sue. Luckily, it wasn't me at this time. It was our industry. The industry sued through due diligence, found the memos where the FDIC was telling all these banks to close the businesses down. And we were able to get our banking relationships back. But businesses is up and down. There is no market for fast bucks right now. I could sell it if I wanted to, but I'm making a lot of money at it, so I just take every challenge and enjoy it while creating other businesses. Did that answer the question?
Thank you.
Okay, I'll take more questions in a little bit, but everybody has a little yellow piece of paper. On this yellow piece of paper, what I would like you to do is write down one thing that you really want, business-wise. One thing that you think you would do most anything to get. So maybe that's a sales revenue number, maybe that's an acquisition, maybe that's hitting a profit goal, whatever it is to you. Something that you really, really, really want and you think you would do anything for it. Write that down on a piece of, that yellow piece of paper. Somebody not have a yellow piece of paper? Everybody have one? So Joe, wall-wise, if there's a little divot left in a wall, is that okay or not okay? Oh, this would be fine, wouldn't it? Okay. Ladies, you want to pass out an arrow to everybody?
Serious.
So as I told you earlier, I bought the Firewalking Institute from Tony Robbins. I mean, not from Tony Robbins, from the guy who taught Tony Robbins how to firewalk. Also taught T.R. Becker, most of the other speakers throughout the country, the world actually. So now one of the things I do is I go around the world and teach other speakers and trainers how to do firewalking and a bunch of other metaphors that you use in these type of environments. So what a metaphor activity like this is for is to reinforce the message. Have any of you in here firewalked before?
Yes.
Just the ones with me, apparently.
You mean actually walking on
so
fire.
What you're actually walking on is you're walking on red hot coals. So we burn wood down to make red hot coals. We take our shoes off and we walk across the red hot coals.
So that's mine over mine.
And why would anybody want to do that?
Why would you not want to do it?
Because it hurts.
Maybe it doesn't. So here's kind of my story. Is I found out, anybody ever been to a Tony Robbins seminar?
Yeah.
And you didn't fire walk or did?
No.
Okay, so they didn't do a fire walk there or you didn't do it?
Okay.
So I found out about a Tony Robbins seminar. I'm really into high energy. So if you come to my boardroom, you'll see that I have a 2,000 square foot meeting room on my property that's decked out with flashing lights and speakers and high-end music and lights and stuff. So I like to do things that make impacts. So with my employees, they get together on a four-day boot camp twice a year. Half of it is personal development, and half of it is business development. So you learn collections and customer service, but you also learn personal development out of it too. So I've been doing this all my life for all the businesses that I own. And somebody told me about a Tony Robbins seminar, and I went, and it was fantastic. The energy was great. Just really going. You're dancing. You're having a good time. And then comes the firewalk. And I had no conception of the firewalk whatsoever. It didn't have a positive or negative impact to me. But we go out and we see this big, huge bonfire going, and all of a sudden I am scared to death. I didn't think about anything of it before. And during the process, he gets you to make a definite decision. You're gonna do it. Here's why you're gonna do it. I get out there and I see this big mound of coals, and all of those definite decisions went away, and I suddenly